The word Advent means coming or arrival. The focus of this season is the celebration of the birth of Jesus Christ in his first Advent and the anticipation of the return of Christ the King in his second Advent. Advent celebrates the revelation of God in the person of his Son, Jesus Christ, as our Emmanuel, God in human flesh, God with us. This divine incarnation allows all creation to be finally reconciled to God. During Advent, our scripture readings reflect an emphasis on his first and second Advent. The themes of Advent are numerous: remembrance, promise, fulfillment, faithfulness, accountability, judgment, forgiveness, mercy, and hope. During Advent, we reflect on the past, rejoice in the present, and look with hope to the future.
Advent symbolizes the spiritual journey of individuals and the church, as we affirm that most ancient of Christian beliefs. Christ has come, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We also affirm that he is present in the world today, just as he was long ago. This acknowledgement is the basis for living holy lives in the here and now of this Christmas season. Advent is marked by a spirit of expectation, anticipation, longing, and preparation. We yearn for deliverance from the evils of this world, first expressed by the Israelites in Egypt as they cried out from their bitter oppression. It is the cry of those who have experienced firsthand the injustice of a world under the curse of sin, and yet who still have hope of deliverance from a God who has heard the cries of his oppressed people and has begun to win their freedom. Advent is the celebration of the promise and fulfillment of our salvation with thanksgiving and joy in our hearts.
This fourth Sunday of Advent represents the worship and adoration of the Lord by the Magi, wise men from the East, given long ago to God's people through the word of the Gospel of Matthew. And behold, the star which they had seen in the East went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshiped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, help us to be earnestly seeking your presence in our lives. Help us to know that you are indeed living within us as God the Holy Spirit, our Emmanuel right now here with us today. Come, Holy Spirit, into this place and fill your people. This fourth candle, which we shall light today on this fourth Sunday of Advent, is traditionally the candle of worship and adoration of the Lord. And it reminds us that the Magi, wise men from the East, were the first to offer God their worship and adoration for his wonderful gift of his only Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. You guys can be seated.
Let's continue to worship God this morning as we sing our next carol, and it's Angels We Have Heard on High. If you wish to stand, you can stand. If you wish to remain seated, that's also fine too. But let's sing out to him and in all his glory.
sing, Christ whose birth the angels sing. Come adore and bended knee, Christ the Lord, the newborn King. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Is Deo Gloria in excelsis Deo Gloria in excelsis Deo.
And you may be seated. And this time we're going to worship God with our tithes and offerings. So if you've brought an offering today, you can bring it forward as we sing this next song. With the plates here in the front, if you wish to do so online, or if you're watching online, you can do that at ClintonNazarene.org, or you can do it through the Planning Center app, which can be downloaded easily too. And before we start this next song. It's the song of a simple drummer boy, and how he didn't have much to offer, but what he could offer was to play for a newborn king. And we can give whatever God has given us, our talents or our time, our abilities, we could bring those to him as this drummer boy did. And you can remain seated if you wish for this last song. Our newborn king to see, ba-rum-pa-pum-pum. Our finest gifts we bring, ba-rum-pa-pum-pum. So to honor him, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, when we come. Little baby, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, I am a poor boy too, pa-rum-pa-pum. I have no gift to
Nice to hear the Palooza boys. that's my brother's favorite Christmas song of all the songs. And I remember as I was older than him by 4 years. I must have been about 8, I think, and he was about 4. And my parents got him this little snare drum. And my dad and him rigged up this little leather thing that he could put around his little lederhosen to go to church, you know, a little German suit there. And then he would come in, and then he actually practiced that, and he actually learned to play that when he was 4 or 5, all that parts like that. And that year when we had the pageant, I was the Japheth King from Europe, at the white guy at the nativity. And my brother came down the aisle and did that, and I remember actually crying. It was so beautiful. My little brother, you know, worshiping God on a little bitty drum. I don't know why. When they were playing that, I could just see him, you know, just going at it. So let's pray. Father, we come before you on this joyous, beautiful Christmas season. Lord, we see all the families and children and those online watching. And Father, we just thank you so much that we have this opportunity to share with the world the most beautiful news anyone has ever heard, that we might be free, free spiritually, free physically, free mentally, that we might be healed physically, mentally, and spiritually. And that we might live for you and not for ourselves. Lord, at this time of the year, there are so many so desperately in need of hope. I was speaking with a man the other day who lost his only son and then his wife, both, either Christmas Eve or Christmas Day within 2 years. And he did not, and he was angry, and he did not want to hear one more person say Merry Christmas. And I just remember you telling me to go to him and just to stand next to him and say that you still love him, that you have not forgotten him. We have this opportunity to just share with the world such joy, but we have a lot to pray for too, Father. You tell us to bring before you our prayers and our petitions. And so today I pray for the Trock family, Father, for Jerry, and for the two sons. We had the funeral yesterday for Frederick, and it was beautiful. And I want to thank you, Father, for my brother Jim and my brother David, who were there to help me to perform that funeral and to give their aid by music and by heavy lifting. And we were able to bring joy and bring hope with us, and it was well received by the people. Today, there'll be another funeral for Lewis Reiner. Father, and I just pray that when Senator Doherty and others are standing there, that you will give me the words of everlasting life, the ones that should be spoken that only come from you. But we have many others who are ill. We're praying right now for Len and his eye, Father. We're praying for, Carol, help me, I'm sorry, for Don, for his back. She came to me this morning, and she said that his back has really bothered him. So let's pray for him. And there's so many others. Right now, I ask you to lift up someone who needs prayer in your heart as I pray these words. Father, come now and touch your people. Heal them. Touch them right where they are. Bring comfort and solace. We ask this especially for the Gilmore family. Ginny died last week, Father. You took her home. And this week, you took George. And there are grandchildren and there are children in that family who are going to have to go through what I just talked about. losing their loved ones near the Christmas holiday. And I ask you that by your angels and by your spirit, that you would surround them, especially that family this morning, and let them know that you have not abandoned them and that you are in every aspect of their lives, even in taking home their mother and father, their grandfather and grandmother to be with you. Comfort them and bring them your joy, even in the midst of their sorrow and their grief. And Lord, we pray for the whole world, that your voice would be heard again from the stars of heaven to the people of earth, to the angels who are ever singing, that people would come to the knowledge before it is too late and you return again, that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that you loved us so much that you came and we beheld the glory of the Father in your face. And that by your perfect life and your perfect sacrifice, we can stand here now and offer up our prayers. And you will hear them from the altar of heaven where you are praying right now for all of us. Lord Jesus, we ask you to meet every prayer that's on everyone's heart right now by your good and perfect will. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. It's time for children's church. So come on down front, children.
Good morning. I love looking at all these faces. I know there's Phoebe. Yeah. Aww. Oh, hey. Well, we've been talking about Advent. Does anybody remember what it means? These weeks before Christmas? Right, that we're so excited. Super excited for Christmas, right? Because it's the birth of Jesus. And I know Pastor Scott's going to talk. We're just going to talk a little bit about it here, and then we'll go down for Children's Church, right? But the story is, remember we talked about how Mary and Elizabeth, her cousin, both had babies, and their stomach, right? And last week how Elizabeth is a little bit older, so it just like up, right? When baby Jesus and Mary entered. So you know that baby in Elizabeth's stomach this week is going to be born. And does anybody know his name? We talked about it last week. Jesus will be born later. Shiloh? John? Yeah. And what's he known as? What's his title? John the Baptist. That's right. And he is a special, special guy. Do you know that Jesus said there is no man born under heaven that is greater than John the Baptist? Can you imagine? Woo! Quite a saying, huh? He had to prepare the way for Jesus when Jesus was born. And then when he came into his ministry, right? He was out there and he's like, repent, repent, right? He wanted to prepare the way for Jesus so that people would come to know who he is, right? That personal thing that we have in our hearts and in our lives. So John the Baptist is so important. Well, you know, his dad kind of didn't fully believe when he was told. So guess what? He couldn't talk the whole time that John the Baptist was in Elizabeth's stomach, right? But when John the Baptist was born, they said, what will be his name? And you know what? All the friends and neighbors and everything were like, she's like, his name will be John. Well, there's nobody in your family with that name. why are you naming him that? She's just because she knew that was what it was supposed to be, right? So she called him John. And then do you know what happened? Zechariah was able to speak again, right? And do you know what he did? I just love this. He has this, he burst out. He has a sort of a psalm or a song that he burst out into, that he praises. That he praises. Oh, is it? Okay. All right. Just want to make sure we're not eating something that we're not supposed to. Okay. And I just think, when I was thinking about that, I was thinking, we should be that excited this Advent season because we're expecting Jesus. We should be that excited, like Zechariah. You know, Mary had one too. Mary gave a big, and we see in the Old Testament, Hannah, right? And it's just beautiful praising God and exalting and lifting him up. He's like the one true living God, right? And that's what he does. And it's so amazing. And I think, am I that excited? Am I like Zechariah? Do I burst out into praise? Is it evident to people that I know who Jesus is in my heart and in my life? So I think that's something that we can think about even when you're small, right? That we can burst out and we can say, we love Jesus. We praise him, right? And so that's what I want you guys to think about this week. And not just this week, but we're focusing on it, right? Okay. So we're going to pray and then we're going to go down to Children's Church. Okay. All right. Dear Jesus, thank you for this day and thank you for this Advent season. We are so excited for your coming to be born as a baby. And we're super excited that you're going to come back again. So I just pray that you would well up in our hearts and we would have this excitement and joy, and it would come out in praise of who you are. We know we need to focus on you. Even though there might be a lot of stuff going on in our lives or around us, we want to focus on who you are. And then everything will be, maybe we might still have a little sorrow, but we'll know that you are the one true living God and that you do have things under control. So we say thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Good.
All right.
All right, let's look at some announcements. Right after church today, we're going to have our Christmas party and our gift exchange, which is a white elephant. It's a game we play and some other games. So if you're going to stick afterwards, a lot of fun, a lot of food. So please stay because there's a lot down there. The ladies have been preparing and people have been bringing all morning. Christmas Eve service will be at 7 p.m. We will have that our normal Christmas Eve then. And Christmas Day, of course, is a Sunday. So this year we will have it as well. Next year, I looked ahead at the calendar. I always like to look ahead what the next Christmas is because I always miss the first Christmas is passing. And next year we'll have to do this again, but it'll be slightly reversed. We'll have to do, because of the 25th, you'll see it. It'll be Christmas twice again. Then after that, for about 7 or 8 years, we'll fall back into just Christmas Eve and Christmas Day being different and not on Sunday. So it's a pleasure to worship Christ both in the evening and in the morning. So all of you that can make it, please attend. We will have full services. There'll be communion at both as well. So if you come to either one, you'll receive communion at Christmas. Oops, went too far. I think there was one more. No, like I said, it was all we had today. Okay, awesome. So here we go. We're going to look at our fourth part of our series in the Gospel of Luke at Christmas. And we're going to, first of all, have the video of the actual, then I'll actually come up and read it. Let's watch the video first.
one more coming.
What name have you given him?
He shall have the name of John.
John? But Elizabeth, there is no one in your family who bears that name. Zechariah would not wish for this. If he could speak, he would want a name that honors such a blessed child.
Where does this name come from, Elizabeth? Where all names come from.
His name is John.
He speaks.
His name is John.
Shlom.
Shlom.
You're building a strong house. It will hold your family well.
I wish to have the roof on before her return, before the harvest.
Joseph, she has never broken a promise.
Atabashlam.
Not in the wind, nor in the earthquake, nor in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice.
You are a good father, Zechariah. It's time for me to return home.
The reality of those events. Let us now hear the word of God. Now Elizabeth's full time came for her to be delivered. And she brought forth a son. And when her neighbors and her relatives heard how the Lord had shown great mercy to her, they came and rejoiced with her. And so it was on the eighth day that they came to circumcise the child. And they would have called him by the name of his father, Zacharias. But his mother said, no, He shall be called John. But then they said to her, there's no one among any of your relatives who is called by this name. And so they made signs to the father as to what he desired for him to be called. And he asked for a writing tablet, and he wrote, saying, his name is John. And so they all marveled immediately as his mouth was opened and his tongue was loosed, and he spoke praising God. Then fear came on all those who dwelt around them. And all these sayings were discussed throughout all the hill country of Judea. And all those who heard them kept them in their hearts, saying, what kind of a child will this one be? And immediately the hand of the Lord was with John. Now his father Zacharias became filled with the Holy Spirit, and he prophesied. Blessed is the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people. He has raised up a horn of salvation in the house of his servant David, and he has spoke by the mouth of all of his holy prophets, who have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to perform the mercy he had promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father, Abraham. To grant to us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all of our days of our life. And you, child, you will be called prophet of the highest, for you will go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins through the tender mercy of our God, from which the day spring from on high has visited us, to give light to those who sit in darkness and light to the shadow of those who live under death, to guide our feet to the way of peace. And so the child grew and became strong in the spirit, and was in the desert till the day of his full manifestation to Israel. These are the words recorded by Luke for us at this moment. And it is another of the great signs that he gave to us in the way he wrote his scripture. So this morning's message, I've entitled the very first line of the praise of Zacharias, for it is really what the whole psalm is about. God has indeed visited and redeemed his people. Amen. In the person of Jesus Christ and the forerunner of John the Baptist before him, we have heard the truth of the gospel. And so we delight in these. I love this picture because that's how they really looked. Well into their 60s or 70s. Can you imagine being that mother giving birth to that child and never being pregnant before, and then finally delivering? And what joy it must have been. As you remember, if you've been going along with us in all these different parts, Luke has a way of telling these stories, always with these acts of faith and songs of praise. The promise of God here was to Zacharias and to his wife Elizabeth, who was infertile and unable to have a child, but they would have one in their old age. And there would be great rejoicing at his birth by all the neighbors, and we saw that also in the video and heard it in the scripture. The character given is Zacharias, a priest, tribe of Levi, had done his 50 years of service and then had been put on furlough. You get put out to pasture, I guess, when you get old enough. But he was called back during the holidays for the special drawing of the lots, the Ummim and the Thummim and the dice. And he was chosen, do you remember, in our very first reading as we started Advent, to be the one to offer up the evening incense to start the holy days. And it was at that offering at the high altar that Gabriel, the archangel of God, came and spoke those first words that Christ was coming, but it would be first through his son, John. The sign given Zacharias' voice was restored as soon as he was able to write down the words that the angel had spoken. Remember, the archangel Gabriel was speaking the word of God, said to him, said to them, to be written down. And now Zacharias would have to write down the faithful words in order to say them. This is sort of a play on words, whether you know it or not, because God writes his written word, the Logos. But the one who speaks it is the living word, the Logos himself, the very mind of, the very heart of, the very will of, the very love of God towards you in Christ Jesus, who became flesh and dwelled among us. So there's a bit of play on words here as well. Luke is really good at that. And so at this circumcision, the name had to be spoken on the eighth day, and John was given. John means, remember, if you went with us a couple weeks ago, God is gracious. First, gracious to Zechariah and Elizabeth, then gracious to the hill country of Judea and the plains of the Jordan, then gracious to all the people of Israel, then gracious to the whole world, because the one who would come after him would bring grace from the cross. And the response of praise that Zacharias gives us is one of the great songs of the Bible. There are seven such songs. And the ones that this is mostly related to, I put in your packet as a side study for you this week. Hannah, or Hannah, as she gave out her great song of praise, to which she was given Samuel the prophet, and Mary, who we just heard last week in her beautiful Magnificat, or the magnificent praise of God. These three are very interrelated, telling the story of God's plan for humanity. Two promises were made by the archangel Gabriel to Zacharias that come true. Number one, John would be born. And we read in the very first line of the scripture, here's what we heard. Now Elizabeth's full time came for her to be delivered, and she brought forth her son. Very similar language, is it not, to what we'll hear on Christmas Eve? And the time for Mary came for her to be delivered, and she brought forth her firstborn son. It's going to be the exact same phraseology for Jesus. And so here he is in the world. But then Zacharias and Elizabeth's relatives would rejoice. That was the other promise. And then when all the neighbors were gathered and all the relatives had heard how the Lord had shown great mercy to her, and they came and rejoiced with her. It used to be not just a family affair. It used to be a community affair when children were born. I remember as a little boy growing up in the church, and every time there was a new baby, a new baptism, a new bringing of life, before, all of the church would gather around that child. I mean, you couldn't even find that child. One woman or another would have that child. And you know what I've seen in our church? Very same thing, right? If Tiffany could do it, she would hoard them. But that's okay. But that's all right, Tiff, because I know how much you love Phoebe. But just seeing her up with the kids, and by the way, we had 12 kids today. I thought, wow, God sent us another whole group of little apostles. Isn't that beautiful to see what the Lord is doing? We've been working towards that since the day I came to help this church to see young people. And I want to be honest with you. I'm rejoicing. I hope you are too. Here again, Elizabeth prays to God. I'm going to go back. Remember her words to Mary? Thus the Lord has dealt with me, and the days when he finally looked upon me to take away my reproach among all the people by giving me this beautiful baby to be. This was her praise over the announcement from her husband, from the angel, that she would have John. John means God is gracious. It actually means full of all of God's grace. In my family, this name has been handed down I don't know how many times. My grandparents on my dad's side weren't very creative. My father's name is Joseph John, and then his youngest brother is John Joseph. But, my grandmother's name, because she came to America, they didn't want her to have a German or a Polish name. So they said, we landed in Virginia, so we'll call her Virginia Rose. And then she had a daughter, and her name is Rose. Yeah, that's right. They were super, super creative. But anyway, John has been a name in my family on both sides of the Polish and German background. Johann, Jan. It goes back all the way, I can trace, to 1550. So it's a name that was chosen many, many times. And it really is a beautiful name. John Paluzzo, sitting in the back. And if you would have been here during band practice, it would have been interesting. But it's good to have John home from London, isn't it, everybody?
Yeah.
Okay. So God is gracious, full of grace. God is first gracious to Zachariah and Elizabeth. Remember what it said about them? They never did anything wrong anymore before the Lord. They were found blameless in their age. Zechariah kept every word as a priest. I mean, imagine if that could be said of us. How many people want that to be said of you? To live for holy lives for God. Amen. And so finally, their prayer is heard. And I relate to them. I'm glad we didn't have to wait till we were 70 to have children. But for 15 years, 9 months and 23 days, my wife, from the moment we got married, we wanted kids. And we couldn't have them either. And being a priest, being a pastor, I had all kinds of well-meaning people come up to me and said, well, if you just had enough faith, it's not what you say. Well, you know, maybe God doesn't want you to have children. That's not what you say. My wife and I took the approach that God was always going to honor it, but in his timing. And so we faithfully every week, once a week, spent a half an hour praying, sometimes more, that God would give us children. And when it came through ministry. So for like Zacharias, I totally get it. It didn't come by any plan of mine. It didn't come by adoption at $28,000 a head because I couldn't afford it as a young officer in the military. It came because a great-grandmother who loved the Lord and saw her family disintegrating around her sought us out. God chose us in her mind. She saw us before she ever met us and delivered those kids to the church where I was serving. They came not as babies. They came as 8 and 9. They came with a long, long line of things that weren't so good. But her heart was that she would find a man and a woman of God to raise those children and start a new family. And today, I am blessed with 7 grandchildren. You know how much I love the number 7. I have 2 others that are my godchildren and adopted grandchildren. And it just continues and continues. God just keeps blessing and blessing when you serve him and you wait and you are faithful. So I totally get it. Number 2, God is gracious to Israel because through John, he's going to call everybody to repentance in order to herald in the days of Christ, who will baptize with fire and the Holy Spirit, not just by water. And then the whole world through Christ, just as promised to Abraham, I will bless all nations through you, right? Going all the way back to the beginning. The sudden intervention of Zechariah's praise from being mute is an act of God. It's what what Luke and John like to call signs and wonders, and what we like to call what? Miracles. That's what we say in our modern time. But it was more than that, because in Matthew, we have signs in the heavens. There were all kinds of different miracles going on, all tying together this birth. And the angel answered and said to him, I am Gabriel, stand in the presence of God. I've been sent to speak to you and to bring you all these glad tidings of good joy. But behold, you'll be mute and unable to speak until the day these things take place because you did not believe my words, which were fulfilled in their good time. So the unwrapping of that muteness becomes a miracle and a sign to the people. Remember when he came out, they said he has seen a sign. He's been made mute. Now he has seen a sign, John being born, and now he is able to speak again. So the neighbors and relatives, what did they experience? First, a great fear, a great, you know, what's going on? Because this is, hey, no 72-year-old woman has a child, right? We know that. Not by biology. Number 2, great awe. They fell down and they worshiped God over this. Did you hear that? They hid all these tender things in their heart. What does that sound like? Mary is another one of those echoes of the people of Judea. And number 3, great wonderment. What kind of child will this one be? And they pondered those things for 30 years until John suddenly erupted like Elijah in the desert, right? Then fear came on all who dwelt around them. And all these things were discussed throughout the hill country. And they kept all these things in their hearts saying, what kind of child will this one be? And they got their answer not too long after. Zacharias' song of praise has 5 parts. I'll try to move along this morning. First of all, it's an old declarative prophetic psalm. And so it follows about 70 psalms in the Psalms. being declarations of praise that David and Moses and others gave as well. It follows a psalm-like pattern if we were to study it. It's a remembrance of God's faithfulness from the past. How many people can look back at all the times God has done something in your life and you know that he is faithful, right? And you know he'll be faithful in the future, amen? That's another thing that Zechariah does. It's salvation for the whole world, not just for the people of Israel, but for the Gentiles too. Zechariah is going to tell us it's for everyone. It was always God's intent to save us all. It's also, he's talking about an actual divine visitation, both in the birth of his son, a miraculous birth when a woman cannot become pregnant in her old age, and then the divine virgin birth that's coming after it. But that through this, it was always part of God's plan to fulfill it just this way, through flesh and blood and God becoming man. And then fifth, he tells us there's a prophetic concern specifically about his son and his role in all these things. Who will John be? Well, according to Zechariah and others, he will be in the spirit of Elijah. Remember we talked about that? He's the one that must come before Christ comes again. And so let's look at this first part, a declarative prophetic psalm. Well, first of all, there's a benediction and a prophecy, and you can study all this at home. I've got it in your notes. Go back and look at the parts. The past, what God has already done. What's he talking about? 39 books of the Bible, and he gives different allusions to different parts. It's a present and a future prophecy, though, as well. Present, what is God currently doing? Here's my son. Let me tell you what he's going to do. Right here in the here and now. So for all of us, when you're out there talking to people, what's the most important thing you can tell them is that God's here right now with you. Amen? People don't want a pie in the sky when Christ returns. They don't want, well, what did God do in the past? They want to know in their hurt and their sorrow and their pain, what can God do for me right now? Amen? How many people need that also as we go through this world? And so when all the things are going around us, we can remind them God's still active. And what God will do, what's he about to do? And let me tell you, we're about to see the craziest times of our life. God is about to unfold and show himself, and he's about to start his return. And when it happens, you're going to look at the Bible and say, boy, those stories weren't even that good. These are unbelievable, the ones I'm watching today. All right. And then there's a number two, a remembrance of God's faithfulness. And these verses you can help. But the main psalm that Zechariah is following, just so you know, is Psalm 106. So read that. That we should be saved from our enemies and from all those who hate us. Who hates us today as Christians? There's not a very long list, is there? Wait a minute. Let me just get rolling here. Our own country hates us. We were the ones that founded it, but now they hate us. You can't say anything anymore. When I taught public school, they asked me to leave because I wouldn't stop talking about you know who. That was back in 2007, 2008. Things have gotten a lot worse. When I was in the military, they said, just preach in any name you want publicly, but not Jesus, or we'll throw you in Leavenworth, Pastor. So I had to leave that because I wouldn't be a hypocrite. You know how many pastors are hypocrites this morning? Go along with whatever. Can't we just all get along? You think Zechariah would say that? No, he wouldn't. And he wouldn't be mean. He'd be trying to make sure he saved your immortal soul so you quit living in sin and live for God in holiness. Amen? You know who else hates us? A lot of the modern Jews. You know why, don't you? He's the Messiah. The Messianic Jews love us because they, are, like us, have figured out that Christ is the one. You know who hates us even more? Islam. Can't stand one iota of us. Because in their religion, he's just another prophet. He's not God. Don't you dare make him Allah, which isn't even a God. We could study that for hours. You know who else hates us? Every secular institution there is. You know who else hates us? Facebook, and we can go on and on. Instagram, it doesn't matter who it is. Twitter. I mean, look at all the files that have come out. Gee, I wonder if they were doctoring the election. You might know what I'm talking about? It's everywhere now, the proof of what happened. In their day, do you think it was any different? Do you think the Romans loved the Jews? Do you think they loved their God? Was it any different for Zacharias and Elizabeth? You see, every time you have real faith, you will be persecuted. You know what nobody wants to hear about the Christian faith this morning is that to be joyful is to be persecuted. Blessed are you. What's those last two in that list? When they persecute you and slander you and say every kind of unrighteousness against you for my name's sake, blessed are you in the next life. Right? At the end of all those beautiful beatitudes are these two. And do you know if you read the Old Testament, the New Testament, it's all about persecution. And it's all about triumphing over it. And it's all about never shutting up about the beautiful truth of Jesus Christ, no matter what they tell you to do. So your job this week, your job next week, and your job the next week, and every moment you have is just to keep talking, keep loving, and keep saying, but don't take any guff. Zero. I don't care whether you're uncomfortable. I don't care whether you're offended. The gospel is offensive because it'll come against your what? Your hidden sin. Amen? Aren't you glad you were offended? Aren't you glad God continues to offend you a bit so you will become more holy? Who's with me? They're always going to hate us. That's okay. They're also going to hell. That's not okay. We need to stop them. Covenant with Abraham. All the way back, God promised it. Covenant with Moses. Look at all the stuff this guy covers. Liberation from Egypt, slavery. Liberation from Babylon, our current government. It's just Babylon. If you don't think so, take a look at what Babylon believed. Reason for liberation, so we could be set free to set others free. That's what our founding fathers and mothers were all about. They wanted us to be free physically, spiritually, and mentally so we could do one thing, set other souls free. Amen? And now they want to re-enslave us. We can't allow that to happen. We just have to say no, and that's it. All right, Zacharias' call to us today, it's right in the middle, that we might serve him without what? If you've got fear when you're being attacked, then you don't know the true love of God. Because perfect love casts out all what? Now, I didn't say you're not going to be shaken a little bit when you see what's coming or the judgments of things that are going to be put upon you. But that kind of fear is just life, physical life. If you have a fear for your soul or fear if you're not sure where you're going or fear how you're going to handle this, you need to get right with Jesus Christ. Amen? You need to ask for the Holy Spirit in double doses because it's going to come. The key is without any fear like other people have. To serve him in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. There couldn't be a better slogan for what the Church of the Nazarene was written than that. Holiness and righteousness unto the Lord. That's supposed to be our byword for everything we do. Zacharias' song of praise, number three, it is a salvation for all story, not for some. We're not like 75% of Protestant churches or the Catholic Church that believes if you don't go to their church or don't do it, believe their way, you're not going to get what? Saved. We don't believe God picks some and leaves others out. We're those weird people who believe the real good news. Everyone's called. Everyone has a choice. Everyone can be accepted, but you have to repent and live for who? Jesus. Amen? Oh, there's a story you can tell. John has a part in preparing the people. John has a part in beginning God's fulfilling that plan to talk about Jesus, whose death and life and resurrection will unravel it all. Salvation is for everyone. No one is excluded, but it comes in stages. First, John, his neighbors, and his relatives. Remember, they pondered all these things in there. They were already kind of on the cusp of all of this, and they knew it. Next, Israel would hear, all of God's chosen people. I am a voice crying in the wilderness. Remember? Remember the priests go out? Who are you, John? Are you Elijah? Are you? I am a voice. Crying in the wilderness. Oh, that we would be voices crying, make straight the way of the coming of the king, huh? Who's coming amid all the clouds of where? Right? Do we have a job this week or what? and last to all the Gentiles. Aren't you glad we were included? Because I don't have a Jewish bone in my body. There's no way I would make it. You know, when you talk to a Jewish person, I'm always careful what I tell them where I came from, because I have to tell them I'm mostly German. That doesn't start off very well. And then number two, I have to tell them I'm Polish. And sometimes that doesn't start off very well. Think about the history, 20th century. Okay. So I always tell them I come from those places, but I'm a true follower of the Lord, and you're his chosen people too. Number four, it's a divine visitation and fulfillment. First, God will be forever with us in the next birth. My son will herald this one, but the one that's coming, the day spring from on high has visited us. Not that he hasn't, he has. How can Zacharias say that? Jesus isn't even born. I had a guy downtown Clinton say to him, I was talking to him about this phrase, and he said, oh, the Bible has so many holes in it. I mean, look at this. Zechariah says that he's visited us. I said, well, do you believe in abortion? He said, yes. And I said, there's your problem. And he looked really, you look bewildered too, what I'm going to do next with that. What did that baby do when Mary said, Elizabeth, Elizabeth, what did John do? He leapt in her womb for joy. Because who did he recognize? Mary? Elizabeth? He recognized the Son of God in the womb next to him. Amen? And I said, so since the baby is a real baby and a real life with a real soul from the minute it's conceived, listen to Zacharias. God has visited us. The day spring from on high has visited us. Why? It's in her womb. He's coming. He's already here, yet he's coming. So then you have this kind of paradigm. He's coming, but he hasn't come, but he's coming. And then he said to me, you're weird. And I said, I have never heard that. I'm quite shocked. And then I said to him, did you catch what I said? He said, well, yeah, I got to believe that the tissue in a woman's womb is really a baby. And I said, until you can believe that, God can't get through to you. Because God became flesh and dwelled among us from the moment Gabriel said to Mary, the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and the offspring that you shall hold shall be called Son of God. And Mary said, let it be done to me. And in that moment, the star appeared, the baby came down, and the first second of creation in that womb happened right. God spoke and it happened. And then he said to me, I've never thought that before. I said, my job here is done. Merry Christmas. All right. Horn of salvation, coming in power to save. Jesus isn't, he came meek as a baby. He died as a lamb, but he's coming back to grab the horns of the altar. You know what that means? To shake the foundations of the earth as the high priest of all. Wow. Listen to that pregnant passage. The one who's coming is coming again. And when he comes again, he will shake the earth. Amen. The prophet that Moses promised. That's in there too. You know, there's only one prophet above all the prophets. It's the last prophet. And by the way, my son's the last Old Testament prophet. And that guy's the only New Testament prophet, because he was before. And all that confusing language. I didn't try that one on him. I would have lost him. All right. But who knows what I'm talking about? If you don't listen to him, you'll be cut off. Everybody, the whole earth, right? People expected a simultaneous salvation and social political change and upheaval and war. Were they right? No. How many of us languishing under heavy taxes and the continued assault would like there to be a new war? I'll be honest. I'd like there to be a new revolution if I could do it. But would that solve it again? No, it would just cause another series of problems. But will there come a day when we have to fight? To defend ourselves, maybe, but not for offensive capability, but yes. Our founding fathers and mothers believed in three things: faith, God's word to make the foundations for all of our government, and guns to protect it. And I am not going to apologize for that. Anybody in here want to do that? You know, the biggest assault on our entire thing is faith, the Bible, and take away the guns. Anybody ever notice that? Or is it just me? Now, am I talking for armed revolution? No. But can you defend yourself? Yes, they're slapping the cheek, and then there's no, you're not killing my wife. So they wanted it all at once, though. What they wanted was this big war, the Romans to be thrown out, they take over and rule forever, but that wasn't the plan. The baby who came as a lamb is coming as a lion, though. How many people are happy about that? Amen. Salvation made available to all. Now, see, normally Jews would say, well, we got it, you don't, too bad. That was the kind of the Old Testament thinking. But Zechariah said, oh, what a poor way to look at it. God loves every soul he ever created, even the ones who are arguing with us. Jesus is going to become our visible high priest. Salvation is here, and it's now for everyone. And Jesus is coming again in the future as our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So he came as a priest and a prophet. He's coming back as king, priest, and prophet, and he's going to fulfill it all. Zacharias continues. It'll be a year of jubilee. Now, whether you know it or not, a year of jubilee was when they gave you back any debt you had was taken away. Any sin you had committed was wiped away. And you got a chance to start all over again. How many people need to preach that one? I got people come to me all the time and say, oh, you don't know. If I came to your church, the roof would fall in. I heard that one three times this week. And I said, I doubt it. I very much doubt it, unless, you know, a meteorite hits it. Because you know what? God is in the, God's the God of second chances and third chances. So many more. All of Israel and all of us will be redeemed. His covenant is dawning, a new covenant washed in his blood. It'll fulfill and it'll surpass the old one, which was just promises. God is doing now. He's going to exceed anything he did before. And let me tell you, when we get into Revelation, anything you saw in the old, it'll be hyperbole. How many people are taking the Revelation study and realize what it's going to look like nothing you've ever seen? Divine illumination. We have been visited by the day spring. What does this mean? The fountain of all life that brought life to the garden. The fountain of all life that brought life to the whole universe is the fountain of life by which you shall be washed from your sins, and the Holy Spirit shall take up residence within you. All that is in that phrase for Jesus' coming. Hear again the prophet Isaiah this morning. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Did you hear that in Zacharias's? Those who dwelt in the shadow of death, that was the last phrase he said, upon them a great light has shined. Isaiah again, arise and shine, for your light has come to you. And the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness shall fall upon all the people. But the Lord will arise over them, over it all. And his glory will be seen upon all of you. John the Baptist. And the glory of the Lord shall come and every eye shall see it together. Do you remember him saying that in the desert after preparing the way? He was quoting Isaiah again. The Gentiles shall come to your light and the kings to the brightness of your rising. Think about the kings and the magi, kind of a foreshadowing event. Even the pagan people shall be called. No one shall be left out. Before my birth, before my throne, and before heaven. Visitation of God brings either, though, judgment, banishment, and curse, or grace, forgiveness, and blessing. Everyone has a what? A choice. Put this in everything you say. It'll either bring you this, or it'll bring you this, because you have to make a decision. There's no fence sitting as an American or as a person living on the earth. Mercy shown in the past by God's steadfast love has said, and his tender mercy in the future. It's a complete cosmic redemption. The whole universe will be saved, according to Zacharias. He's right. All the forces of darkness who are in opposition shall be defeated. All of our enemies shall finally be put at our feet. Forces of light bring victory and peace. Play on those words this week. Light and dayspring. Be a dayspring and bring light to the world. Finally, his prophecy concerning his son. John will be the forerunner of the Messiah, just as Elijah will be at the coming of the end. John is a last of the Old Testament prophets. He's compared to all of them, according to Zacharias. He's a prophet of the Most High. John is subordinate to Jesus. Remember John saying this later? I am not fit to untie even his sandal strap. because the great I am was before me, and before I was, he already was. All right, there's that as subordination. John compared to David as a servant and as a son. All right, we're getting to the end. John fulfills Isaiah's prophecy. Comfort, yes, comfort my people, says your God. Speak comfort to Jerusalem. Cry out to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, for she has received from the Lord's hand double for all of her sins in the past. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in a desert a highway to our God. Every valley shall be exalted. Every mountain and hill shall be brought low. The crooked places shall be made straight. The rough places shall be made smooth. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. Can you imagine the second advent of Jesus? White horse, banner on the side, dipped in blood, King of kings, Lord of lords, trillions of angels, and here's NASA. They're looking at the grid and trying to figure out if there's any space where there's not a space being taken. Will every eye see it together? Yes, even those who have condemned and even those who have killed him. There's John. There's who John's going to be. John's prophet to the promised prophet. So the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was manifested to Israel in due time. And here's what Luke says. It is he who will go as a forerunner before him in the spirit and the power of Elijah. That's going to happen too in end times. Elijah and Enoch are coming back. Can you imagine the DNA 23 on those? I can't wait till they run the DNA check on those two boys. It'll be so great. It'll be like, well, Enoch here, he's about 5,400 years old and he's still living. Any word? Well, you know, I used to walk among the stars of heaven on the staircases, and it was quite the thing when he took me in the 365th. And all those, you know, all those weird stories will become true, right? And us conspiracy theorists, oh, sure, he took somebody and took them up a stairway to heaven. Oh, yeah, right? Now, Led Zeppelin got something, right? Okay, anyway, and then, little joke for those of you who love music, they got something, right? Number two, can you imagine when Elijah comes back? All you false prophets of Baal, standing there tempting them to bring their God. Where is your Antichrist now? Huh? How old is he? Well, about 3,300 years old, the DNA test says. But his teeth look good, not like a horse. Okay, anyway, I can just see people. I know I got a weird sense of humor, but I can't wait for stuff like that. Told you. Here's the question of the day. What is similar about Zacharias' day, John's day, and our day? What's the most similar thing? We live in a persecuted, we live under strong imperial governments. We all live with our sin, whether it's forgiven or not, and it needs to be. We all live separated from God without Jesus Christ. There's a lot of similarities. But the main one is God still chooses to bring his will to the world through you, his servants. Do you realize what a privilege? Do you realize what a responsibility he's given you? How many people are almost intimidated and excited at the same moment? Anybody besides me? But how many people are glad you've been chosen somehow? What a gift we have to give to a world who's never going to find the answers without them. And we each have a mission, and each of ours is different, to go into the world, but to be like Zechariah and John and to testify to the great gift that has been given you, the presence of God himself dwelling in the human heart. That's the gift. It's the only thing that can change anything. We've been given this by God the Father through his only Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. As you embrace the baby in the manger, embrace the love of God in your heart and give it away. Become pregnant with God's holy joy and give it away. That's Christmas. This Christmas, you and I have an opportunity to be the modern forerunners of Jesus' second coming. And it's coming soon. We can be modern evangelists in the spirit and power of Elijah and John the Baptist if we'll live the holy life John led and his son and his father Zacharias and his mother Elizabeth. We can announce Christ's second coming when he will literally be forever with us. What? Forever our living present Emmanuel. Can you imagine no need for a building like this with lights and all that? Because when you get to heaven, there'll be no more temple. For he himself will be there, God in their light. Do you long for that like I do? People need that. They need to hold on to just that because this world is soon to pass away. Let us tell everyone we meet and greet this Christmas season that we are the living proof that God has indeed visited and redeemed his people.
Well, please stand as we sing one last song and before we go downstairs for time of fellowship. And this is I know many people, this is one of their favorite Christmas songs, and hope you're just blessed by so singing it and just worshiping him.
Let all within a
us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Oh, praise his name forever. His power in glory and more
hearing Greg attempt that with the week, last couple 10 days he's had, is a blessing just to hear him do that because he, let me tell you, he came really close. He came really close. This is your benediction this week. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. Take that word, take that love to a world so desperately in need of it, and save them, as Jude says, by reaching down and drawing them out of the fires of hell while there's still time. Go now in the love and the love and the beauty and grace of God. And all of God's people said, amen. That'll also work for our prayer downstairs to eat, so go right on down.
What?